as our God. I know nga ang among mga pulong, among mga pagdayig, dili gyud maka-express who you really are as our God. But by your grace, O God, we ask that you accept our sacrifices of praise, our thanksgiving in response, Ginoo, sa imong gibuhat sa amoa. You gave us life through your Son, Jesus Christ. You restored our relationship with you. Through Christ, we have this wonderful, personal, individual fellowship with you. Nga adlaw-adlaw, Ginoo, ma-amaze gyud mi perminti. So manang karon nga buntag, I ask that you unite our hearts as a congregation, that we may give you the honor and glory that you deserve in our singing, in our listening dinha sa imuhang mga pulong, sa pag-commemorate sa imuhang kamatayon dito sa cross, ug bisan pa sa imuhang fellowship together as we converse with one another later on. I pray nga naagyod ang heart to edify one another and with an acknowledgement, Lord, nga wala gyud mi mabuhat kung wala ka. In you, we live and move and have our being. Mo nang gi-entrust na mo sa imuha ang among pagsimba from start to end. You offer na mo inyong tanan to the glory of your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I would like to invite everyone to please open your Bible sa 1 Corinthians 15, 1-58. So follow lang ta. I will read. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, then your faith is vain, and ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now Christ is risen from the dead, and become the firstfruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the firstfruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom of God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he hath put all things under his feet. But when he said all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. Or else that what shall they do which are baptized for the dead, if the dead rise not at all? Why are they then baptized for the dead? And why stand we in jeopardy every hour? I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. If after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage it me if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. But some man will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened except it die. And that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain, it may chance of wheat of some other grain. But God give it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial. Another of glory of the moon, another glory of the stars, for one star differs from one star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. Howbeit that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is of the Lord from heaven. As is the earthly, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heaven, such are they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, at the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Amen? That's our hope. And we all know that here in 1 Corinthians, this is actually Paul's case, no, in the reality of bodily resurrection. And we are hoping to that. This is the foundation of our faith. Manang ningon si Paul dinha, Christ has been raised from the dead, and in Christ all will be made alive. So as believers, this is our confident expectation. Kung ningon tag hope, di ni wishful thinking. This is our confident expectation. So since Christ has been raised from the dead, then we who are in Christ will be made alive at His coming. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is our blessed hope. And the reason why we can sing hallelujah, praise the Lord, is because Christ assures us of our glorious future. Amen? So part sa ato ang kantahon karon, ningon diha, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. So akong ngayon ang tanan sa pagtindog o atong kantahon ang mga alawiton. Thank you.
our hope in life and death. Christ alone, Christ alone, what is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand.
Let's sing hallelujah.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now whenever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Can calm the troubled soul. God is good, God is good. There is His grace and goodness known. In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends away that brings us nigh to the shore, the rock of Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters, let's sing hallelujah.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now whenever we confess Christ our hope in life. Grave, what will we sing?
Christ still lives.
Christ still lives. Christ still lives. And what a gift will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him. There we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will is ours forevermore.
Yes, Lord, we praise You.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and
continue to declare our blessed assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, righteous of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood.
All together.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descend, of mercy, whispers of love.
This is my story.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
This is my story.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
For the last time, let us declare, this is my story.
This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song,
amen,
praising my Savior all the day long.
We praise you, Lord, not only today, but every day of our lives until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And for all eternity, we are going to praise you.
Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hope. And divine, I can sing, all is mine.
together. The night is dark.
The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and never is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can see I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Amen. Oh, we are free, oh Lord.
With every breath, I long to follow Jesus. For He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
To this I hope,
to this I hope, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
When the race
is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Yes, Lord, we declare,
yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Let us all declare, yet not I,
yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Yes, Lord, we give You honor and the praise that You deserve. Whatever Your church will accomplish in this life, all the glory and honor belongs to You alone, because we acknowledge, O God, that apart from Your strength, we can do nothing. And so we say, yet not I, but through Christ in me, in us, O God. This is our prayer and thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us give Him a clap offering.
through His power, His grace, that will give us all the power to listen, to deliver, to share the Word of God to everyone. And for today, you might find the title of our message today a little bit odd. Reaping what we sow, a quick survey of Paul's letter to the churches of Galatia. Yes, it's a little bit odd because there seems to be two different types of topic that we will be listening today. But then you might want a quick survey. As I was preparing this message, I was only focused actually to Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 to 10. But as I started digging deep in the study to get a background and the correct context, according to our pastors here, Pastor Ayan and Pastor Janjan, that's what they always tell us, to get the right context when you study God's Word, I noticed I was already making a quick survey to the whole book. Yes, I was already making a quick survey to the whole book. So instead of just focusing on Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 to 10, in which I really intend to focus on that later, I would like to invite you all to join me in this journey to do a quick survey of the Apostle Paul's letter to the churches of Galatia. So before anything else, let us bow down our heads in a word of prayer. Our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, Lord, for your faithfulness. Thank you, God, for the power. Thank you for the grace that you have given to all of us and to me, that as I bring to you, to the brethren, your message, you empowered me. And I'm so confident, O Lord, because you are the ones, you are my confidence. And I pray, Father God, that you may remove anything that is in part of my human nature, that all the glory and honor will only be given to you. I pray, O Lord, that may your name be continually glorified as we go through your word today. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, please open to the book of Galatians, chapter 6, verses 7 to 10. And just follow as I read. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially to the body of Christ. Or who are of the household of faith. For us to understand the context of these verses we just read, let us examine the background behind them. Yeah, I mentioned that already. And allow me to go over to the book of Galatians and just make a quick survey. Anyway, it won't really go beyond 1 hour. Okay, don't worry. We have our discipleship later, and yeah, we have our lunch. That will be okay. Allow me to go over to the book of Galatians and just make a quick survey and identify some important facts to set the stage that will enable us to see and understand the reason why Paul wrote this stern warning to these churches. So, the book of Galatians was written by the Apostle Paul for the churches of Galatia. And that happened in AD 58. And this is when he heard the news that the believers of these churches were deceived to believe that following the laws of Moses, specifically of circumcision, is an essential part of justification. As the servant who planted these churches and must have personally known these believers, he did not withhold his emotion when he rebuked the members of these churches and correct the wrong gospel that they embraced that was taught to them by the false teachers. We must take note that the Apostle Paul's intention when he wrote this letter was to win back those believers who went astray by embracing the law as part of their justification back to the truth. That is justification through Christ alone. To make his point, Paul, the apostle of Christ and the spiritual father of the Galatian believers, immediately defended the true gospel by declaring monumental facts about his election and the veracity of the gospel he was preaching. So let's go to the different facts. Fact number one, he declared the authenticity of his apostleship. Paul begins his narrative by declaring the authenticity of his appointment as an apostle of Jesus Christ. And his appointment was ordained by Jesus Christ and God the Father themselves. No men or by mere men. Galatians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, an apostle, not of men rather than man, but neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Fact number two, he declared the true gospel. Galatians chapter 1, verses 3 to 4, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father. So what is the gospel? It was read already this morning, earlier by Pastor Ian, and let me read it again in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 4. Moreover, brethren, I declared unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye, in memory what I preach unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Fact number three. He declared that there is no other gospel. He immediately declared that there is no other gospel aside from what they had preached to them before. Galatians chapter 1, verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. The word accursed in Greek is anathematizo, means to declare or vow under penalty of execration, or an object of curse. And Paul was so serious with his declaration that he reiterated his point in the following verse. In verse 9, he said, as we said before, so say I again, if any man preached any other gospel unto you than that you have received, let him be accursed. Fact number four. He disclosed the source of the gospel he was preaching. He revealed that the gospel he was preaching was not given to him by man, but a direct revelation of Jesus Christ himself. Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 to 12. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached to me is not after man, for I neither receive it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Fact number 5, Paul explained the uniformity of the gospel he was preaching with the leaders of the Jerusalem church. He explained to the Galatian believers that he shared the same gospel he preached to them with the leaders of the Jerusalem church, and they accepted it. The proof of its veracity is that even Titus, the Gentile believer who was with Paul at that time, was not compelled to be circumcised. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3, then 14 years after I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and took Titus with me also, and I went up by revelation and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to them which were of reputation, lest by any means I should run or had run in vain. But neither Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. Okay? Neither Titus, who was with Paul, was compelled to be circumcised. Fact number six. Paul explained his assignment to the Gentile people. He explained to them that it is clearly understood that he was to preach the gospel to the Gentiles, as Peter was to the Jews. In verses 7 to 8, but contrariwise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter, for he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. Fact number 7. He further revealed that his assignment to the Gentiles is supported by the leaders of the Jerusalem church, and further explained that the pillars of the church, namely James, Peter, and John, recognized and agreed that he should preach to the Gentiles together with Barnabas. In verse 9, and when James, Cephas, that is Peter, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. Fact number 8. He warned that hypocrisy is deceiving. He also went further to explain that hypocrisy will cause the brethren to be led astray, just like what happened to Peter when he was in Antioch. In verse 12 and 13, for before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles, but when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of circumcision. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas was also carried away with their dissimulation. You see, when Peter was in Antioch, he fellowshiped and eat with the Gentile believers. But when they came in verse 13b, these people were believers but were zealous of the law, Peter withdrew from the fellowship. And because he feared that he will be criticized. What makes the whole event worse was that the other Jewish Christians joined Peter's hypocritical behavior, and even Barnabas was carried away with their hypocrisy. Fact number 9, that man can only be justified by faith in Jesus Christ. Only by faith in Jesus Christ. Paul clearly explained that it is not by the works of the law that man can be justified. For no one will be made right with God by obeying the law. In verse 16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Fact number 10. Paul declared that the law has no part of our justification. It is an offense to the gospel of Christ if they or we will once again embrace the law, the one that we already rejected and thrown away as part of our justification. Because through the law, they died, but they live for God. In verses 18 to 19, for if I build again the things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. For if I through the law am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. Fact number 11. Paul identified himself with the death of Christ. That Christ is now the one who runs his life, and that he is living his life by faith in Jesus, who loved and gave himself for him. Verse 20. This is a very popular verse, and I'm sure many of you had memorized this. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Fact number 12. Jesus Christ did not die in vain, because righteousness only comes from him and not from the law. In verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Now let me continue by having a quick rundown of the following chapters. In chapter 3, Paul continued to lay down pieces of evidence that the true gospel is only through faith in the promised Messiah. And we have that there in chapter 3, verses 2, 5, 6, 7, 9, 11, 14, 18, 22, 24, and 26. And that Abraham was saved because of his faith in God, and through him all the nations will be blessed. In verses 6, 7, 8, 9, 14, 16, 18, and 29 in chapter 3. And that the law cannot render justification to those who follow it. Instead, they will be under curse. Found in verse 2, 3, 5, 10, 11, 12, 13, 18, 21, 24, and 25. And that the law in verse 17, which was given 430 years after God promised Abraham the coming Messiah, did not break God's promise, because of what God promised, God will do. In 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 56, blessed be the Lord that hath given rest unto his people Israel, according to all that he promised. There hath not failed one word of all his good promise, which he promised by the hand of Moses, his servant. And our God is also a God who cannot lie. In Titus chapter 1, verse 2, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. And that there is no more barrier or division regardless of our ethnic background, social status, gender, we are already one in Christ. And because we are already in Christ and identified with him, we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. In verse 28 and 29 in Galatians 2, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male or female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. In verses 1 and 2 in chapter 4, okay, we are now in chapter 4. There are six chapters here, so we are more than halfway already. Paul pictured the Galatian believers as baby Christians. They are heirs, heirs of God through Christ in Galatians chapter 4, verse 7. But like a child, still under the supervision of a guardian. And the sad picture is that the guardian here is the legalism that the law has taught them. Remember, they embraced the teaching of the false teachers, the Judaizers, to follow the law as part of their justification. Then in verse 3, he shifted to their experience, their personal experience, that before Christ came in their lives, they were slaves of the principles of the world, just like us. Before we came to Christ, before we knew him, before we put our faith in Jesus, we were controlled by the principles of this world. Until God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law, and redeemed them from the fetters of the law. God redeemed them already and received their adoptions as sons. God indwelt in our hearts the spirit of his son, who calls Abba, Father. With that position, we can call God the Father, Abba, Father. The presence of the Spirit of the Son of God in us made us worthy to cry, Abba, Father. In Galatians chapter 4, verse 6, and because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. And in verse 8 to 20, Paul expressed his concern based on his personal experience with the people in Galatia, the first time he came to them and shared the gospel. And in verses 21 to 31, he gave an illustration through an allegory of the lives of Abraham's two sons. Ishmael, born of a slave, Hagar, was born after the flesh. And Isaac, born of a free woman, was born by a promise. Sarah became the mother of Isaac, and just like Isaac, we are the children of promise. Amen. But the one born after the flesh, Ishmael, persecuted Isaac. But the Bible says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 30 and 31, nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. As children of the free woman, we are no longer subjected to being enslaved by the law. So Paul instructed the Galatian believers that since they are already set free in Christ, they should no longer be tied up with the law. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Because trying to be made right with God by keeping the law will bring them outside the sphere of God's grace. Galatians chapter 5, verse 4, Christ is become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law. Ye are fallen from grace. Fallen from grace. fallen from grace in this verse doesn't mean that the Galatian believers had lost their salvation. Because Paul addressed them as brethren, meaning fellow believers, fellow Christians. And how many times? 11 times. And he uses the pronoun us and we that includes him as part of the body. Rather, it means fallen out of the sphere of God's grace. No one can live in both spheres. Either you live under the sphere of the law or live under the sphere of God's grace. You cannot mix both. You cannot be in both spheres. What is tragic here is that when a believer falls into or falls out from the sphere of God's grace, he will no longer experience all the blessings that Christ has intended for him. But when a believer walks in the light of God's word, he lives in the sphere of God's grace and experience God's goodness. But when a believer chooses to live in the sphere of the law, he denies himself spiritual freedom. He denies himself spiritual riches and puts himself back into bondage and emptiness. In verses 6, 13, and 14 in chapter 5, in Jesus Christ, circumcision nor uncircumcision benefits nothing, but faith that works in love. You are called to live in freedom and use this freedom to serve others in love. Loving our neighbors as ourselves is the sum total of the whole law. This law can only be achieved if we live a life that is controlled by the power of the Holy Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 6, 13, and 14. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. In verse 16 and 18, we are instructed to walk in the Spirit that we will avoid doing the lust of the flesh. For we are not under law if we are led by the Spirit. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. But if ye led by the Spirit, ye are not under law. Verse 17 allowed us to gaze at the two opposing forces that can never be joined together. In other words, we cannot be in both sides, not even in the middle. Either we are inside the sphere of the law that leads to destruction, or we are inside the sphere of grace that leads to victory. In verse 17, it says here, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. Verses 19 to 23 is the presentation of two vividly described pictures. The first picture is of what manifests in a life of an unsaved soul, and even the life of a believer, the life of a believer who will stay inside the sphere of the law. A picture of a believer who wasted, okay, if he will stay inside the sphere of the law, he is a picture of a believer who wasted and squandered his freedom. And he went on and just go with the flow with his sinful desires. And the opposite is a picture of a believer who lives under the control of the Spirit, thus bearing the powerful and positive fruit, which is love. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, inveighings, murders, drunkenness, reviling, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, meaning Paul has been warning them against all these fruits of the flesh, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against all these is no law. And for a believer who commits his life to obedience to God's word and his instructions, just like Paul, all his affections and lusts are crucified with Christ. He will strive to live a life and live a life in the Spirit and avoid the works of the flesh. In verse 24 to 26, and they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vain glory, provoking one another, inveighing one another. And before we proceed to the last chapter, wow, we are now in the last chapter. Please be reminded that the beginning of this letter, Paul clearly showed the Galatian believers the big contrast between a person who embraces the law that leads to destruction and the person who has the faith in the promised Messiah that leads to blessing and victory. In this final chapter, he laid down clear instructions on what to do with a brother who will fall away from the true gospel. Remember, this whole letter is focused on explaining and providing that there is no other gospel aside from what the Apostle Paul has preached, and that anybody who embraces the law will be led to destruction. In Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. From the Greek word paraptoma, the word fault in this verse means an intentional error. Remember, they were being deceived by the false teachers. This is not referring directly to chapter 5, verses 19, 20, and 21. Instead, it is referring to brothers or brethren that fall out from the sphere of God's grace. Those who are godly, those believers who did not follow the teachings of the false teachers were instructed to help restore those who have fallen, and at the same time, we are being warned not to be complacent about our spirituality, or else we too will be tempted. In Galatians chapter 6, verses 2 to 3, bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. We are instructed to bear one another's burdens so that the law of Christ will be fulfilled. And the law of Christ here is the gospel. From the Greek word anapliroo, the word fulfill in this verse means to complete. Therefore, if we bear one another's burden, the gospel in us, the law of Christ, the gospel in us will be complete. It is important to help and support one another in the church so that no one will be swayed into believing another gospel. Yes, we are instructed to readily help anyone in the body of Christ who falls into sin and not be deceived by thinking that we are too important to help. We cannot just say, just leave it to them. Anyway, that's too small for me. Okay, they can handle it. We cannot do that. Remember, it is when we support, encourage, pray, and stand up for one another in the body of Christ that the gospel of Christ will be complete. And as we engage with the work of the church, may it be in the ministry, any ministry, or restoring a fallen brother or sister, we should not compare ourselves to others. Instead, let us check our motive and ask questions like, is my response to the call glorifying to God? Is it in line with His will? Do I have a clear conscience as I respond to this call? That after you did the ministry of helping or being active with something for the Lord, you can rejoice deep in your heart alone with the Lord without really getting... without boasting. Verse 4, but let every man prove his own work, and then he shall have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. Because we are instructed in verse 5, for every man shall bear his own burden. In verse 5. Let every man shall bear his own burden. This verse sounds in conflict with verse 2, that we have to carry everyone's burden. Now in verse 5 we are told, for every man shall bear his own burden. Okay, so the word burden in verse 5 is portion, which means part of a freight or a cargo, like your own personal thing, the one you are carrying now. It can be your Bible, it can be your bag, okay, something that you can really carry. And the word burden in verse 2 comes from the Greek word baros, which means burden, heavy burden from the heart. So if we will go through the whole thing, in as much as we are told to bear or carry each other's burden, that is to edify, build up one another in verse 2, we are also instructed or warned to be responsible in taking care of our personal spiritual walk with the Lord. We should not say that we are very spiritual already because we are so active in the ministry. We cannot go on spending time helping other believers, working in the ministry, attending Bible studies and prayer meetings, and yet we do not have the discipline to spend time alone with the Lord. Spend time alone with the Lord in prayer, meditating His word, and most importantly, obeying His precepts. We can be active in the ministry. We can always be active in the ministry, teaching and admonishing one another, praying for one another, and also we must spend time alone with the Lord, studying His word, meditating His word, obeying His word, and in prayer. As we are reminded also to focus on our personal spiritual walk, we are at the same time reminded to consider God's servants who are ministering to us with spiritual food. In verse 6, let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Let me dwell a little bit in this verse. Our pastors, Bible study leaders, our disciples, and anybody who teaches us God's word in its purity are the ones God used to nourish us spiritually. Verse 6 is instructing us all to share our material blessings to them. You might say, but our pastors are being paid. They receive salary. Are you not being paid? Are you not receiving salary? Are you not receiving gifts from friends, from your business partners, or your company for good production? More so, our pastors. We have been praying for them, all right? We have been supporting them. Yes, we love them. We express it to them. We express it in words. But we can better express our love to them by sharing our resources. Dili na PM is the key. Okay? Dili na PM is the key. Action is the key. And who should be our model when it comes to loving in action? Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God commandeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. My dear friends, action is the key. Do not just pray. Of course, we have to pray for our pastors, but do not just pray for them. Engage them with your blessing. And in Romans chapter 15, verse 25, it hath pleased them, verily, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles have been made partakers of the spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. The pronoun them in this verse refers to the Gentile believers in Macedonia and Achaia in the northern and southern regions in Greece. They were so pleased with the spiritual things they received from the Jerusalem believers, and they feel they must share their material blessings. So think about that. So after showing proof of his apostleship, defending the veracity of the gospel, explaining and contrasting the law and faith in Christ, the sonship of the believers, showing his concern for the Galatians, presenting an allegorical argument, explaining a believer's freedom in Christ and what it means to live by the Spirit's power, Paul showed us the two fields in a very obvious manner where we can sow and the kind of fruit that we will reap with a stern warning. Do not be deceived. So let me read again our text, Galatians chapter 6, verses 7. To 10. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. The word deceive in this verse comes from the Greek word planao, means go astray and be out of way. This warning refers to the first chapter of the book where Paul rebuked the Galatian Christians for perverting the gospel by embracing the Judaizers' teaching of circumcision as part of justification. Paul warned not to go astray. Otherwise, we treat God's word with contempt. Nobody can treat God with contempt and get away with it. Yes, our God is a loving God. He proved it on the cross despite our unfaithfulness and unworthiness. But then remember, He is also a God who is righteous and just. In Psalm 89, 14, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Steadfast love and faithfulness go before you. And He is also a jealous God. Exodus 34, 14, for thou shalt worship no God, no other God, for the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God. So can we get away with it if we treat God with contempt? My dear friends, God is a perfect, God in His perfect justice showed us what we will reap if we sow to the flesh and what we will reap if we sow to the Spirit. If we sow to the flesh, we will reap corruption. We will be accursed. We will dwell within the sphere of the law and eventually manifest the works of the flesh. Sow to the Spirit, we will reap everlasting life. We live a life led by the Spirit, and the Spirit will bear in us His fruit, thus following, allowing us to live a victorious life. Let me show you a rundown of the two fields a believer, the two fields a believer can sow in his life. The two fields. We have here the law, sowing to the flesh that is living within the sphere of the flesh. And the Spirit, sowing to the Spirit, living within the sphere of God's grace. Oh, it's too small. Is that clear? Okay, if you sow in the field of the law, you're object of a curse, you're a hypocrite, never been made right with God, under bondage, persecutor, outcast, and not an heir, fall from grace, bear God's judgment, and fulfill the lust of the flesh. The works of the flesh are manifest in them. They reap corruption. And those are the corresponding verse that describes those believers who will sow on the flesh. And if you sow on the Spirit, this is beautiful. Justified by faith of Christ, dead to the law, live unto God, crucified with Christ, children of Abraham, blessed with faithful Abraham, redeemed from the curse of the law, receive the promise of the Spirit through faith, children of God, baptized into Christ, Abraham's seed and heirs, worthy to cry, Abba, Father, no longer a servant, but a son and heir, children of the free woman, persecuted until now. Yes, have you experienced persecution? Have you? Okay, praise the Lord. Children of promise, made free, called unto liberty, led by the Spirit, bore the fruit of the Spirit, bore one another's burden, and reaps everlasting life. Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 4, Christ is become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law. Yea, are fallen from grace. So question, which field would you like to sow in? the one that will yield destruction or the one that yields life everlasting? Or should I ask, to what field are you sowing right now? To what field are you sowing right now? My dear friends, I am fervently hoping that none of us are doing the good works that God has mandated us to do, to add strength, to add security, to add efficacy of our justification. Our justification was completed by Jesus Christ on the cross. You received it, we received it, the moment we believe in Him as our Savior. But we have to make this very clear, that God's children, as God's children, we are commanded to do good works. Okay? We are commanded to do good works. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. We need to do good works that God has prepared for us to do. We need to do all these things, not for our justification, but for our sanctification. We do the good works God has prepared for us to do because we are already justified. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, we are already justified, and we are also declared children. In Romans chapter 8, verse 16, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So, our challenge as believers in Christ, let us sow to the Spirit and remain within the sphere of God's grace, that we will not be swayed to believe wrong teachings from false teachers. Let us sow to the Spirit and remain within the sphere of God's grace, that we will enjoy God's presence and continue experiencing His love, goodness, faithfulness, His strength and power as we face the difficulties in life, while we fellowship with the church, encouraging, edifying, and admonishing one another. Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 to 10. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. In conclusion, my dear friends, faith in Christ is enough for our justification. He is the only way to the Father in heaven, John 14:6. We cannot add anything whatsoever for our salvation. No amount or type of good works can add to our justification. Remember, adding something to our justification will only lead us to sowing to the flesh. We might not be led to destruction because we are already in Christ, but we will be out from the sphere of God's grace in our Christian living and eventually miss enjoying His presence, His blessing, His fruit, and His victory in this life. Let us pray. Our most gracious and loving, wonderful God, we are so thankful, Lord, for Your clear presentation of Your word. Thank You, Father, for warning us that it is that our justification, our salvation is already complete in Jesus Christ. And I pray, Father God, that may Your word will continue to enlighten us, that we will not be swayed to believing other form of gospel, other forms of teachings that will somehow teach us, Lord, to believe that we need to add something for our justification because Christ is enough for us. And Father God, I also thank you for your faithfulness as you continue to be with us as we move on with our worship service. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God who is working in us. And I pray, God, that as we move on with our service today, even as we celebrate the Holy Communion, we'll always be reminded with what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, O God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Salamat sa Ginoo, sa iya ang pulong, pinaagi ni Sir Max. Every time we are reminded of the gospel, we are sure that we are blessed. No? And karon, we will again remind each other of the gospel that we have received through this ordinance, the Lord's Supper. So let's pray. Let us remember that Christ has once and for all completed the sacrifice and that we are able to come into the Father because of the perfect sacrifice of the Lamb of God. So let's pray, and then as we hear the song, let us meditate on the lyrics and let us get the elements of the Lord's Supper. We are reminded that what we are going to do this morning is a remembrance, an instruction for remembering the death of Jesus Christ, the purpose of his death, and what his death has accomplished. Also, we are instructed to look forward to his coming, to his vindication, to proving that he is righteous, he is holy, and he is alive in the future. And by that time, our joy will be complete. Amen? Let us prepare the element that reminds us of the body of Christ. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us all partake. Let us prepare that which symbolizes the blood of Christ. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us all partake. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Brothers and sisters, we are also reminded that when Jesus did this with his disciples, he emphasizes to them that they should love one another. And each time that we are to partake, we are reminded about the great commandment of our Lord Jesus Christ that we should love each other till the day that he comes, so that we may be effective witnesses as we wait for his coming. Praise be unto you, O Lord, our Father in heaven, who loves us with holy love, with righteous love, a love that disciplines us, a love that molds us into Christ-likeness each day and each circumstance in our lives. You have enabled us, Lord, with your grace. You have indwelt us, O Holy Spirit, that we may understand the words that we have heard this morning, and that we may enjoy as we partook of the Lord's Supper this morning, reminding each other and ourselves that our Savior is alive and that one day he'll be coming back again for his people. So praise be to you, Father. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Once again, good morning. Are you blessed? It's a blessing to be reminded, no, time and time again about the gospel. No, sa tuang engagement diri sa kalibutan, daghantag mga butang nga nabuhat, no? We experience success, achievement, for every time we're reminded of the gospel, it humbles us. Amen? Because our life is not about us. It is about God, no, the Lord Jesus Christ, working in us and through us. So munang at the end of the day, when we are reminded about the gospel, we give God all the glory that He deserves, no, whatever accomplishment that we have in this life. Amen? So even as a church, no, na po yung mga accomplishment nga atong na-experience. Pero together with that kind of understanding about the gospel, we give God the glory that He deserves, and we humble down ourselves. Another thing po day, personally, ako ma-bless kay ko every time ma-remind sa gospel, because it reminds me that we are all equal here in the local church. Amen? So walay labaw sa tua. Mabitaw na nga, ganahan ra ko tawag og brother ayan, no, para walay labaw. Ate, kuya, manginana ra. No? Sa edad lang siguro ta maglahi. Pero we are all brothers and sisters in Christ. So muna nga, dili ta dapat ma-intimidate, no, kung kinsa na atong tapa diha, that's our brother. And we need to love one another, pray for one another. So the Lord is good and is greatly to be praised. Okay, before we go to our announcement, we would like to acknowledge our visitors. They're here for the first time. So akong gihangyo kung matawag ang imuhang ngalan, if okay lang, to please stand. Una, si Valerie Dabatos. Asa si Valerie? Okay. And then si Geraldine Tan Leones. Makahinomdom ko ni Kuan Natay Leones pod nga kanang brother, pero nasa Davao. Dili ba ni sila igsoon? Si Kerwin? O, oh, dili rari. Pariha lang og kanang apelyado. Okay. Catherine Bahaw. Okay. Thank you. So, in behalf of Family Christian Fellowship, Valerie, Geraldine, and Catherine, now we welcome you. Salamat kay sa inyohang presence nahimong part sa atong worship service this morning. So it is our prayer nga makauban ginhapon mo namo kung available mo. No, you are always welcome there is a Family Christian Fellowship. So God bless sa inyo. I hope na bless mo karon nga morning, and daghan pa pud tay mga fellowship dere. So if you're available, welcome regid mo always. Sa ato ang announcement, una sa tanan, before na ko ikuan ang announcement na to karon nga bulan, dako jud kayo atong pasalamat. Ako personally, dako akong pasalamat. We're blessed sa ato ang celebration, no? Sa ato ang Thanksgiving dito sa Talibon. And dito ta sa sports center. And puno-puno jud ang sports center. No, it's good to really see brothers and sisters from different places. No, hearing the word of God, duha pagyud kabuto atong speaker. No, nya daghan po kay tag mga singers to inspire us, no, with the message of God's word through singing. And then unsa pay naka-bless na to? Murag na puno po na atong tiyan sa pagkaon at timailhan nga the Lord has really blessed us, no, mga different nga mga local churches. So tagsar to nga panghitabo and we're so blessed to be part of that. So katong mga wala nagka-attend, sunod, I know nga naay mga good reason gid ang uban nga wa kaadto, ang uban na baby, no? So we pray for that na the Lord will give them kuan kanang safe gyud nga kanang delivery, no, normal delivery. So daghan tag mga madugang na pud diri sa kuan sa FCF and we are so blessed for that. So mao na nahitabo atong 26. So wala tay service dire pero I hope nga katong wala naka-attend, nakatan-aw ra ba mo sa online? I think nag-online ya. Yeah? Okay, salamat sa Ginoo. Nag-online si kuan Pastor Janjan, no? So kana isa na sa atong mga gipasalamatan. Now sa atoang kuan, sa atoang activity for the month of July, una sa tanan after the service we'll have our discipleship class. So we invite everyone, no, to join. And then after ana, especially nga tagsara bitaw ta magkita, no? We really encourage nga kanang i-deepen pagyud nato ang atoang fellowship together. So we desire nga makastorya, no, bisag mubo lang a time later on. Anya naputay lunch time. So di na ta maghunahuna mo uli og unsay atong kaunon. So everything will be provided after the discipleship class. And then another, karong July 9. Okay, hapit na nga atoang online seminar. Last time ni attend ko sa yesterday ni attend ko sa Pastor's Fellowship dito sa TBC and then gi-promote po ni nato. So I hope nga daghan sa ato ang mga pastors and pastors' wives will be joining us aning online seminar. So it is about a study on evangelism and discipleship. So timely ni para sa ato ang tanan because we are called to evangelism and discipleship. So July 9, Saturday na siya 10 to 10:45 a.m. sa buntag ni. So mas nindot nga maka kuan mo kanang katong wala pa naka register. So naagya po i-post si Pastor Janjan sa ato ang FCF group chat kay murag natabunan na to dito sa taas na pod ang ato ang link. So i-click lang ninyo. So actually mao na siya ang link din ha. Kana ra gud inyo hang fill upan, full name, email ad, contact number, church or organization. So 2 to 3 before the schedule, ang organizer will send you a link sa inyo hang email. So during the day, inyo ra tong i-click makasulod na mo dito. Pero kinahanglan nga mag install mo og blue jeans. So we will not be using Zoom nga kuan apps, we will be using blue jeans. Free ra pod gihapon na. I think ang katong mga naka-join sa atong previous nga kuan kanang online seminar, naara siguro gihapon to sa inyong cellphone. So you pwede ra to. Pag-click ninyo sa link, diretso na mo ana makasulod. Okay? So kana. And then as of June 30 day mao ni ang mga kuan kanang naka-register. I think madugangan na kay mga pastors pod nakahibalo pod sila atong mga outreach pastors. No, mga members. Next, July 27. So, mauni siya ang nahitabo, no, sa ato ang men's breakfast prayer meeting. So, we encourage nga madugangan pagyud ni sa mga men. So, mga kuan ladies, let us push our men, no, nga mo join ani. Dako ni kahimuan pod sa among personal nga life. Ma-discipline pod me through prayer and I hope ma-strengthen pagyud og maayo ang among personal prayer. Dili lang individually, but in participation sa body of Christ in prayer. So, dili na sa FCF Worship Center. And then libre na pamahaw. Sa sunod siguro prayer and fasting, kani prayer and feasting. Okay? So July 10. So next Sunday afternoon, so men's fellowship and women's fellowship. And then July 17, so in the afternoon, no, sa atoang targeted topic. So mo ni atong topic, lifestyle and finance. So natay mga qualified nga speaker ani coming from here, atong mga accountant, no? So si Kuan, si Ninang Bibi og si Ninang May. So they will be our Kuan kanang mga lecturers ani nga time. So pwede juta, the whole family can attend ani nga seminar. And then July 19 to 22, kinsay kinder to grade 4 diri, taas ang kamot. Murag wala, may mga bata diri na, okay? So para ni sa ilaha, Vacation Bible School. So diri ra sa Family Christian Fellowship every 2 to 4 p.m. with Pastor Levy and mga teachers. No, nga ning appeal ani. So murag dugay-dugay na pod kay katong mga nilabay ng mga tuig. So wala gitay activity ngayon ani. So, gi-invite na to ang tanan. So, kung namoy mga friends po or silingan maka inyong mga bata, pananghid lang sa ginikanan, pwede po maka-join na. Especially, diri sa to ang kanang community. Okay? So, another. July 31. So, natay sports evangelistic event. So, kung mangkabantay mo, everyday, daghan dyan kayo magdula diha. No? Nga mga, diri na siya sa to ang community. So, i-pray na to, isa na sila sa ito ang mga target for this activity, nga maka-join sila sa ito ang short lang, natay murag league, short nga league, sa itong basketball, volleyball, and then ping-pong. No? So, with price ni siya, dili ni Kuan, na-adjun po ni siya price nga insakto. So, I hope nga ang pinaka-importante yun ani, nga ang gospel, masyeran sila. So muna itong ibutang ang gospel tunga-tunga kay para naan na sila tanan, makadungog sila sa gospel. So I encourage no the whole church nga ato gyud na i-pray nga ang ato ang community diri ma-saturate gyud with the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So invite your friends. Kung taga diri mo, invite. Pwede ra man pud og lagyo, no, katong mga hilig og basketball. So pwede pud maka-join ani. And then mangutana dai ko, nabay basketball na schedule karong hapon? Wala ra? Basketball karong hapon. Okay, busig nakalimot na po ko. Okay, so kana ra sa 4 down, no? Na pa ba? Okay, Tuki on every Wednesday, every Saturday, ato ang corporate prayer meeting. So we encourage, no, katong wala pa ka-join. So nindot kayong experience ni. And then, sunod. IDC classes na to. Book 1, Spiritual Discipline. Book 2, Doctrine of Salvation. And then Evangelism Training. Every second and fourth Friday of the month. No, 7 to 8:30 p.m. Diri ra na sa ito ang worship center. So usually, diri ang book 3. And then book 2. Og, duha ka book 2 dito. Niya. Diri po ang book. Book 1 day. Book 1 niya. Book 2 diri sa kilid. Pero magdungan ta na diri. So napoy short nga singing. No, corporate singing. So we encourage everyone, no, to be part of that. And then lastly, sa ato ang offering, no, nakaibalo naman siguro ta na adya sa isig kakilid na to. And to before we pray, no, sa ato ang offering as an act of worship po na to sa Ginoo, I would like to read passages. 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I directed the churches of Galatia, so do you also. On the first day of every week, each one of you is to put aside and save as he may prosper so that no collection be made when I come. So makakita ta diri ang pinaka-ultimate nga purpose sa giving is for the saints. No? So help yun na nato mo nang natin mga outreaches, we help them, no, mga needs ato mga brothers and sisters. And then another principle that we can learn there is that our giving should be regular on the first day of the week. So mao day na, no, every Sunday nganong mag-give ta sa ato ang offering as a support, no, sa ato ang mga ministries, no, tungod kay na I need, dili na ta kinang kung na I need, di na ta kinang lang magkolekta para ready na ang ato ang kanang budget, no. And then to put aside and save. So kung maghunaw na siguro tagpila may akong ihatag, no, as the Lord prosper you. Okay, you know how the Lord prosper you. So, kuan ni siya kanang from the bottom of your heart kung unsa ang gi-impress sa Ginoo to give, no, for the work of ministry. So, as partners, we are all kuan invited, no, to give. Pero dili ni siya pugos nganuman. Kani akong basahon diri karon, nindot pud ni ngan siya. Now this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do just as he has purpose in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good work, as it is with good deeds, as it is written, he scattered abroad, he gave to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increasing the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in everything for all liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only fully supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing through many thanksgiving to God. Because of the proof given by this ministry, they will glorify God for your obedience to your confession of the gospel of Christ and for the liberality of your contribution to them and to all. While they also, by prayer on your behalf, yearn for you because of the surpassing grace of God in you. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for all your blessings that you have poured out in our lives as your people. You are indeed a good God. You are indeed a caring Father who meets the needs of your people. And even there are times, Lord, you overflow us with provision and resources so that we can also be an instrument to meet the needs of other people, especially here in Family Christian Fellowship. You have used us in many ways to extend blessings to the outreach churches, to the outreaches and partner churches, even to individuals who are in need. And so we thank you, Lord, for that opportunity that we can be a channel of blessing. And so we honor you through our giving, through our offering. We acknowledge that this is all yours. And thank you, Lord, that by your wisdom and guidance, dinaasi mo mga pulong, we can be a good steward of what we have. So all the glory and honor belongs to you alone. In Jesus' name, amen. For our last song, I would like to invite everyone to please rise. So kung familiar mo, the last month, no, same gyapon sa itong Communion Sunday, we sing this song, and I felt kanang led to sing this again. No, kay para ma-familiarize na tugmayo, nindot yung kain niya nga kanta, reminding us always nga all the glory no, be to Christ alone. So let's sing this song. All glory be to Christ.
all glory be to Christ.
Let's all declare.
All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ. When on the day that shall live with us and be our steadfast life, and we shall e'er his people be. All glory be to Christ.
All glory.
All glory be to Christ our King. All
honor and all the praise, O God.
All glory be to Christ.
Once again, from the bottom of our hearts,
all glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ.
Amen. Forever and ever, O God, for all eternity, we will be singing that, O God, all the glory be unto you alone. Amen. Amen. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is well-pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And all the people of God will say, amen and amen. God bless my dear brothers and sisters, and let's continue to enjoy God's presence.